Hello, my name is Tony Fisher and today I'm going to reveal how I made the world's largest Rubik's Cube. I've been thinking about making this for some years now, but I was never quite sure how to do it. I'd thought of different ways of like just scaling up the mechanism, but I figured it'd probably be too heavy that way and too difficult to make. So I finally decided on a way of doing it. I must admit at the time I had no idea whether it would actually work, because it seems like a very fragile way of doing it. But it got to the point where I just decided I'm just going to give it a go and just see what happens. So under here is my secret mechanism for the world's largest Rubik's Cube, which I will now reveal. Yes, it's another Rubik's Cube. We don't need that. This is an 18 centimetre mass-produced Rubik's Cube. This is the largest mass-produced cube that you can buy. And I figured that perhaps I could extend this into that. Now I know that kind of sounds crazy, but, well, I did it. So how do you actually go about doing that? Well, to extend it, let's put it down here, you need plastic pipe. So I've got this 40mm plastic pipe and I'm fixing it to every single cube, all 26 external cubies. But then of course, what do you make the cubies out of? So that's kind of another issue that I toyed with quite a bit. My initial thoughts was a stuff called Cellotex. So I'll show you what I experimented with. This is Cellotex. It's like a lightweight foam stuff. So my idea was to construct boxes from this Cellotex stuff. But I didn't like it. It's even though it's foam, I felt it was too heavy. And this, by the way, this is a little bit larger than these. So this would have resulted in a 1.80 meter cube, which was kind of a little bit big, to be honest. So I didn't like this stuff, rejected it. So do you do it in wood, plywood? Too heavy, it's not gonna work. So then you think of cardboard boxes. But surely cardboard is too fragile. It's going to squash. It's not going to work, is it? Or maybe it will. Okay, so I experimented a bit with cardboard. So, an experimental cardboard cube, obviously smaller. How do you attach it? You've got the pipe. How do you attach it into the cube? It's not easy. So I experimented with this stuff, expanding foam. And you can see, put some in here, it actually holds surprisingly well. In fact, I can't pull it out. So that was a good start. You know, I'm thinking with this, this could work. I mean, the whole thing might be too fragile and just fall apart or break. But I'm kind of getting somewhere here. So, full-size cubies. Full-size cubies. So, basically, you're doing that, cutting a hole, that through the hole right to the bottom, expanding foam to hold it, but also expanding foam around the edges inside, which gives it more of a strength to it, and then attach it to the cube. Simple, right? Well, I've got some clips now. I'm going to show you off some of that process, because I'm actually recording this video now, obviously after I've done it, but I took some footage during the construction process.
So obviously if I'm extending one of these cubes with this kind of pipe, this is just a short bit just to show you, I'm going to have to find a way of attaching it, like one piece on the corner, edge, middle, and obviously, you know, on all 26 cubies. So it's a case of finding out the best way of doing it. Well, if I start with a centre, let's take a short piece of pipe. What I did, I glued a piece onto the centre, and then, actually if I turn this over, these caps come off. So I glued it like that, and then filled in with milliput, like that. And then I made a mould of that piece, so that's like a master now. Made a mould, and then I was able to cast extra pieces. So I'm just recreating that piece. So it's obviously, because it's all resin, it's fixed. It's one lump of resin, so it's never going to come off. So those, the centre pieces, could just fit on there, and they could be glued because there's a good sort of seam around there, so they could be glued into place. And then there's these connector pipes. They fit over the top, and then your normal pipe fits over that. So that's like a way of attaching the centres. And I obviously used a similar technique for the corners and the edges. So for a corner, for example, I made this. This is a master, and that fits over there. So again, when I'm casting the pieces, I can then fit it on there just the same. And there's plenty of room for it to glue on really, really solidly. And the same applies with the edge. So that's kind of your, that's the three different types of pieces that were required. Now, because the resin pieces are quite heavy, and you know, much heavier than they need to be, I actually drilled holes to lighten them up a bit. I mean, I don't know if it really made much difference, but I thought it would help, and they're still plenty strong enough. So that's kind of how a final middle looked.
The next stage was to assemble the cardboard boxes, attach and secure the pipe, and use the expanding foam to reinforce the boxes around their edges. I was tempted to fill the boxes entirely with foam, but that would have made them far too heavy and taken literally hundreds of cans. If you're wondering, by the way, how many cans I did use, it was this many. It wasn't until I had a few boxes assembled that I could test if the puzzle was likely to work. As you can see here, initial testing was promising. I knew, however, the edges were far too sharp and needed rounding. This doesn't sound like much, but it's not that obvious how it should be done. At this stage, I had no idea, but a solution suddenly occurred to me. Bash it with a hammer. Since the edges are reinforced with expanding foam, the strength of the cardboard is not compromised. Having done this though, you're left with very untidy edges. The solution is gaffer tape. Up close it looks pretty bad, but from a distance it looks fine. Initially I was only going to use it on the edges and paint the rest of the cubies. However, I liked it so much that I used it on all the areas which must be black. Along with the expanding foam, it also strengthened the cardboard and made it waterproof. I used around 350 meters of 10 centimeter wide tape.
This weighed around 2 stone, which is around 1/8 of the total weight of the finished puzzle. With all parts finished, I was ready to do the first, and hopefully the only, full assembly. I still had no idea if it would work or be strong enough, but I was cautiously optimistic. I had assembled the cubies in such a way that everything just slotted into place and very little was fixed. I figured this would give the puzzle a degree of flexibility and also be far easier to repair should there be a problem. Remember, I've never made anything like this before, so I'm learning as I go along. I wasn't even sure the best way to assemble it. I could have speeded this assembly up or cut bits out, but I decided to just leave it as it is. After assembly, I was ready to test it. Unfortunately, as you can see here, movement was very poor. I tried tying string around the top layer, but that never really made much difference. I could see there were some major issues, and I was nowhere near finishing the puzzle. The first issue I dealt with was a poor design of the factory-made Rubik's Cube at the centre. You can see here on the left that they were really stingy on the plastic, so I made the modification you can see on the right. The way I did this was similar to the way I made the connectors for the pipes, rubber moulds and cast resin pieces. On the right, by the way, is a spider which I had already reinforced with Milliput. I'm casting parts for both edges and corners here. This is how they look partly assembled. The next issue I dealt with was a plastic pipe sliding off. It was clear that they had to be properly attached, so I drilled holes and used bolts and wing nuts. So all the modifications have been made, and I am putting it back together again. My fear, however, is since I have eliminated the looseness, it will now be much more fragile. It can't really flex anymore, so it's liable to break instead. The latest testing is good, and although a bit stiff, it seems to move okay. To test it fully though, I need to take it out of my garage. Everything seems fine, and it moves in all directions. Have I really just made the world's biggest fully functional Rubik's Cube? I think maybe I have. So now for the stickers. I knew that just attaching regular ones wouldn't look right. They would be very uneven and get ripped off very easily. So I used 1mm thick plastic sheet, covered in a regular material, and then covered in a clear material for protection. I must admit, I got pretty bored with doing them very quickly. I had kind of felt I'd finished the cube and really couldn't be bothered with many more hours work. It was very tricky to apply the stickers to the plastic without getting air bubbles, and the same with the protective covering. There are 54 stickers on a Rubik's Cube, so I had to repeat the same awkward process 108 times. The 54 stickers weighed 2 stone, like the gaffer tape. Combined with the tape, they accounted for 1/4 the total weight of the puzzle. Finally, they were done, and the next few hours would be spent attaching them. I used over 3 litres of Evo stick. I started with the spray, but ended up using regular pots. So late into the night, I finally finished stickering it. I would leave them to dry overnight and test it in the morning. The puzzle seemed fine, and I set up cameras to make my first demo video. My intention was to make a checkerboard pattern and then return it to a solved state to prove that it functions fully. The first half of the video went fine, but when I started to put it back again, disaster struck. There was a crack, and I knew something had broken. I replaced this broken part with another part, but that broke very soon too. So the part that broke is this from here. It's the same area that broke previously. So I had actually been using these sort of reinforced bits, because basically that and that are obviously the same. So I put this piece in here, which I thought would be enough to make it stronger. But it's still breaking, so that's not working. As you can see, the configuration of spring and screw is like that. That then obviously goes onto the main core. So it's quite difficult to reinforce this without interfering with movement. So my next plan is to do it like this, and then fill this area with resin. So this washer will kind of attach the shaft more to the area, because I mean that's all that's happening is the shaft is, I mean the shaft is quite strong and sturdy and quite thick plastic, but it's this joint is just awful. It's really thin plastic here, so hopefully that will work. This was Sunday the 14th of February 2016. The puzzle worked. I was able to complete several moves, including the full checkerboard pattern later for my second demo video, and also for a news agency that came around 2 days later.